Morning, everybody. This is really a pleasure for me. It's a very important far-ranging topic, and we have a really quite a phenomenal keynote speaker and a wonderful panelist who's going to join him. I'm a professor in the law school, and this event has been put together by Melissa Kessler and Michelle Wallace and Chris, who's one of the panelists, Transforming the Landscape, Healthcare Law and Advocacy for Transgender Clients is the topic that we're going to talk about today. Our keynote speaker is Noah Lewis, who I just met Noah today, but so I probably want to never say this to somebody, but I actually saw him on YouTube and I said to Chris, you have to bring this man to Astra. He's amazing. So I was very committed to hearing Noah even before this morning when I met him. Noah is a graduate of Harvard Law School. He was, I think you said, Noah, the first openly transgender person of any gender to graduate from Harvard. When he got out of law school, he worked on cutting-edge impact litigation for transgender legal defense and education fund in New York, right now? Yeah. And he now runs his own firm in New York, Transcend Legal. The name of his talk is The Way Things Are, an overview of current legal doctrine and advocacy in transgender healthcare. After Noah's address, he's going to be joined by Chris Jawanka in a panel discussion about the issues that Noah discusses. It's really a joy for me to introduce Chris because, well, first of all, Chris is wonderful, but second of all, he's one of our senior fellows at the Gitenstein Institute for Health Law and Policy. He's worked in particular on our legal mapping project, which I would love to, but won't take time to describe right now, but it's going to be online very soon, and it's part of our advanced care planning work. Chris is also a researcher at the Center for Policy Research at SUNY Albany. We're really delighted to have both Noah and Chris here. We at Gitenstein are very, very grateful to the law firm Garfunkel Weil. A few of their attorneys are here this morning. And we're grateful to Garfunkel Weil Partners, Robert Wild and Judith Eisen, for a generous gift that the firm gave us that has allowed this speaker series to be implemented. Without Garfunkel Weil, we truly would not be here this morning. So we are very grateful to you, to your firm, for that, and for your continuing support of our work in the Gitenstein Institute. Mr. Lewis today is going to focus on legal doctrine relevant to transgender healthcare, but it's, you know, I think you don't even have to think about it to understand, and this is probably more true than one would think in every domain, but here it just sort of seems obvious that to be an effective advocate to represent transgender clients, as well as Noah does, one has to know something that goes way beyond legal doctrine. One has to know about the assumptions of a wide set of transgender people, and it's perfectly clear that within no group, or probably even two people the same. So within any group, understanding the culture of that group is far more complicated than one might think. But in addition, and quite as importantly, I would think, one has to understand the presumptions, the assumptions, the challenges presented. We're talking about a healthcare universe, so by healthcare professionals and by the society more generally. How is it that they see members of the transgender community who might be patients or potential patients or past patients? And I know that one of the reasons that Noah has been able to do truly marvelous work for his clients is because he understands legal doctrine and he's a bit of an anthropologist. So I say that because I actually am an anthropologist as well as a law professor. And for me, that's a very big compliment. I just want to quote Noah on that front. He has explained, and I'm quoting him, the biggest challenge in the legal realm for transgender clients, the biggest challenge mirrors the biggest challenge facing trans people in general, namely having one's true sex recognized and respected by others socially and legally. Noah, it's a joy to introduce you.
Thank you, everybody, for coming, and to Hofstra for hosting, and Chris for wonderful organizing, and the Institute. So thank you. So you just heard, my name is Noah Lewis, and this stop here on the presentation is to remind me to tell you about Transcend Legal, which is a new nonprofit organization. We are at the moment handling a huge uptick in requests for name and document changes, but our primary focus is healthcare access. And I'm circulating a sign up sheet if you want to learn more about our work to sign up for that. And if you're tweeting, there's our Twitter handle. But we're going to. I told you before I did that. So we're going to look at kind of the problems, and then we're going to go along the path to the legal solutions that exist. But before we can get on that path, we need to do a little bit of background information. So we're going to start off with talking about trans healthcare in general. So, first question for you, what is trans-related healthcare? Do you throw some ideas out about that? Yeah?
Hormonal therapy?
Yeah? Yeah?
Mental health counseling?
Mm-hmm.
Any kind of healthcare that affects anyone?
Sure. Nobody wants to say the surgery. that tends to be what people think of, but it is a lot of other things. It's cross-hormonal replacement therapy. It's surgery, not just for genitals, but also for secondary sex characteristics. On a day-to-day basis, we don't determine. You look at each other and we put you in a box of male or female. We do that unconsciously. And we do that based on secondary sex characteristics. So things like stature, voice, facial hair. Here we can see the differences in, does anyone want to point out some of the differences between these two?
Mustache,
facial hair?
Adam's apple.
Adam's apple. He probably smells a lot more than she does, and he might have more of a pronounced brow ridge, and his jawline is square, and he would also have more muscles. So those are things that are affected by hormones. So we also mentioned mental health care, hair removal, not just facial hair, but you also need permanent hair removal associated with genital surgeries. Puberty suppression is when you stop puberty in its tracks to give a transgender adolescent more time to before they go on hormones that have permanent changes. Puberty suppression is fully reversible. And in fact, These two are identical twins. They were both assigned male at birth. This is Nicole and Jonas Mainz. You may have heard of Nicole. She's a little bit older now. But the reason why she didn't go through male puberty is because of puberty suppression. And fertility preservation is something that's really cutting edge in this country, although in other countries like Amsterdam, it is covered under health insurance. So that would be sperm banking or egg banking before undergoing genital surgeries. And I say trans-related or transgender-related healthcare as opposed to transition-related healthcare. Why? Because if we say transition-related healthcare, it plays into the idea that trans people are always and forever transitioning and never really their affirmed sex. Hormones are used throughout life, but that doesn't mean that the person is constantly transitioning. And to say transition-related implies that surgery makes the man or the woman. And in reality, somebody who needs genital surgery, a transgender woman is already a woman. That's why she needs the surgery. It's not as if the surgery doesn't transform a man into a woman. Just like if you, if you're not trans, if you're not trans, you're cisgender, by the way. C-I-S is the Latin prefix that corresponds to trans, and it means same. It means that you identify with the sex that you were assigned at birth. So if you're cisgender and you underwent genital surgery, that would not suddenly make you the other sex, because our sex is in our brains, not our genitals. So you can just say transgender-related surgery. So who needs trans-related healthcare? The vast majority of trans people. There's kind of a movement to de-emphasize the importance of access of healthcare because of people not wanting to say that you need to have surgery. Yes, you should not need to have surgery to change your identity documents. You should not need to have surgery to use the bathroom that corresponds to your gender identity. But that doesn't mean that trans people don't need surgery. What percentage do you think of trans women have had genital reassignment surgery?
5%?
And what percentage do you think want surgery?
Right.
Yeah, so more people have had than, so about a quarter have had it, but about 90% want it and have not been able to get it. And in this particular survey, they did not ask people about facial reconstruction surgery, which would undo the effects of going through puberty, male puberty, but 17% of the women responded in the survey that they'd had it. And it's often more important for transgender women who want it and need it than genital surgery, because that's not something that you have to display on a daily basis. And 3/4 also want to need breast reconstruction. While estrogen does produce some breast growth, it's for, especially if you're older, if you're transitioning and you're older, it's not going to be enough to have a typical female breast. And trans men, even lower, about 6%, I think it's maybe closer to 1 in 10 now, have had genital reassignment surgery. But again, 9 out of 10 want it. 93% want or have had chest reconstruction. Closer to 50% of trans men have been able to get chest reconstruction because it's much cheaper than genital reassignment surgery if they're paying out of pocket. And 80% need hysterectomy. Hormones, that top bar is the percentage who have had hormone therapy, and then it's wanted. So again, the vast majority of trans people want or have had hormone therapy. So why do trans people access trans-related medical care?
First of all, for the same reasons anybody would access medical care, and people need medical care. And secondly, for special needs of trans
Anyone else want to add to that? I think there's a perception that trans people are having surgery to conform to a social stereotype or because of social pressure. So I would just push back on that and explain that it's to achieve comfort in our bodies, period. You know, when I was in law school, it was very hard to focus on my studies because I, you know, when I would look down to read, I could see my breasts, and that it causes this cognitive dissonance, this dysphoria, that it's just constant. You can't escape from it. And you know, I didn't have surgery for anyone else other than myself too, and it worked. You know, it really made my life a lot better. So, but in order to access any of this care, you first need to have insurance coverage. So, unless you can pay out of pocket. So I just wanted to take a minute to talk about that. And the Affordable Care Act has several provisions that are important. First, you can't have transgender discrimination. You can't deny somebody health insurance because they're trans. There's no more pre-existing conditions, exclusions. In 2007, when I applied for an individual plan, you know, I was willing to pay for it out of pocket, but they denied me coverage because I had the pre-existing condition of gender dysphoria. But that's not allowed anymore. And there are increased penalties for not having health coverage. Sorry about the delay here. So, open enrollment is open now. It's open through the end of January. If you buy through the marketplace, people can get subsidies, tax credits. There are additional non-discrimination protections that come into effect if you buy through the marketplace. Even if the same plan is available off the marketplace, you want to encourage people to buy it on the marketplace so they get those protections, and encourage people to use navigators because they can really help people figure out which of all the, you know, deductibles and copays and what plan will work best for them. If somebody's outside of the open enrollment period, there are other reasons why they can get coverage. If they quit their job, they lost coverage, marriage, children, moving to a new state, citizenship, gaining citizenship, leaving incarceration, and you can apply for Medicaid anytime. So the next, we have one more piece of background before we can move on, and that is to understand the origins of trans health insurance exclusions. So there's a perception, if I ask you now, so there are explicit exclusions in health insurance plans that, you know, if you look under the exclusion sections, it says, you know, we don't cover dental care, we don't cover services provided to family members, all those kind of random exclusions. And then it says sex transformations, or sex reassignment surgery, or all treatment related to gender dysphoria. So do people want to throw out some reasons why those exclusions might exist?
Cost.
Claim that it's not medically necessary.
Mm-hmm. That was your answer. Yes. So, there's a perception that these exclusions are justified, that they're normal, that they're natural. Of course, transgender care is common. You know, if you read any news story about transgender healthcare in the comments, you'll see people saying this is cosmetic, pay for it out of your own pocket. And there's also this idea that this is based on some kind of medical, you know, basis, that that's the consensus right now. So, but if we think that the solution is pointing to medical research and trying to say, no, this is medically necessary, or showing that it's low cost, then we're kind of already we've already lost. Because we're kind of arguing on the terms of the status quo. So if we think exclusions are natural, then trans people bear the burden of proof to say, no, you should add coverage. You know, maybe it was experimental in the past, but now we have to add coverage. But if we see that exclusions are animus-based, then it's the exclusions themselves that have to be justified and not coverage. So, you know, why are you singling out this one particular medical condition by name for exclusion when there are no other medical conditions that are listed in your exclusion sections for exclusion? You know, it used to be the case in the 90s that HIV treatment was explicitly excluded, or it was capped at a much lower rate than other coverage, and that was obviously because at that point they could get away with it. And that's kind of, you know, that's essentially what is happening here. They can get away with it. Insurance company wants to cut costs, and this is one way they can do it. So, in looking at the historical framework to understand why are these exclusions, how did they come into place, why do I say that they're animus-based, what's my evidence? So does anyone know what this is? Yes. And like super bonus points if you know what they're actually burning. I can't guarantee it's this particular picture, but one of the main things that they were burning was the records of the Institute for Sexual Research founded by Magnus Hirschfeld. And he was somebody who pioneered research, you know, scientific research into gay and trans folks, and for the first time saying that, you know, A, that they exist and that there's nothing wrong with it. And he was also active in trying to get rid of paragraph 175 of the sodomy law. But when the Nazis came to power, one of the first things they did, he was also Jewish, was destroy all of his research. So there had been sex reassignment surgeries performed in the 30s in Germany. We were, you know, that was the direction it was moving in, and then all of that just was, you know, up in smoke. And it was set back for who knows how long. So in the 60s, there was a gender clinic. There were lots of gender clinics. It was standard at places like the University of Virginia, Stanford, around 40 to 50 universities had clinics, and Johns Hopkins was one of them. They were the first one. They were one of the biggest ones. And then in 1979, this guy, Paul McGue, got it shut down. And Paul McGue is Catholic, and he had religious opposition to sex reassignment surgery. It wasn't medically based. But once the Johns Hopkins clinic shut down, all the other ones eventually closed their doors, except for Michigan. That one had, I think, it stayed open the whole time. And it's only now that these university-based clinics are popping back up. And thankfully, they're coming back up very quickly. But again, concerted effort to deny trans people healthcare. This is Janice Raymond. She wrote The Transsexual Empire. And she was involved in getting the Medicare exclusion for trans-related healthcare. Her work was used in that government, the decision-making process. So again, a concerted effort to deny healthcare, which wasn't based on science. It was based on her political views about trans women being men who were destroying feminism. Okay, so that's some background. And now, what are some of the implications of these trans health exclusions? It's not just the fact that trans people can't get health care through their insurance. It's a whole host of other things that come into play. So if we start at the animus towards trans people that drove the exclusions, what is that that leads to the exclusions? And then if the procedures are not covered under insurance, providers aren't going to perform those surgeries because they can't get reimbursed. So there's only a handful of surgeons in the US until recently who could even perform these surgeries because it wasn't taught in medical school. And it became kind of a cottage industry for a few folks who only took out-of-pocket payments, and it just became concentrated in a few hands. In New York State until recently, until I think this year, I would argue, I think there was no one who could perform genital reassignment surgery in the entire state of New York. So it means lack of access to treatment. And if you don't have lots of people getting the treatment, then you can't have studies, you can't have population sizes to demonstrate that this is effective care. There's only one case, forgetting which type of study it was, the one where you break them up initially, you assigned people to a waiting list versus surgery. And that study showed that the people who got surgery did better than the people who were put on the waiting list. But there's only one study like that. And then if you don't have the studies to show the effectiveness, well, guess what? It's cosmetic, it's not medically necessary, you can't prove it. So this has been the situation, and it extends beyond the healthcare realm. It extends to employment, extends to education, because the idea is basically that trans people are delusional, that anyone who would want to have this surgery is mentally ill, and that justifies the firing and justifies the exclusion of trans kids from the bathroom because you just have this delusion that you think you're a boy, but you're really a girl and you shouldn't be allowed to use the boy's bathroom. And also it has deep effects on trans people themselves. When I was in law school and my student health plan had an explicit exclusion for the care that I needed, I had to start questioning myself, am I crazy? If it's not covered by insurance, maybe there is something wrong with me, maybe I shouldn't be having surgery. So in addition to the explicit exclusions, there are other types of denials of care. So there are three main buckets of denials of care that trans folks are facing. So the first one is sort of lowest hanging fruit. Members' gender is not valid for procedure. So if a trans man goes for a gynecological visit and he's listed as male on his insurance, the insurance computers will automatically deny that by saying, because they have for fraud prevention and error prevention, gynecological exams are only females are allowed to have those. So in the past, sometimes that was it. I'm not going to get coverage for that. But now that's no longer the case. So the way to challenge these is first to just call the number on the card and explain the situation. And the frontline person is probably going to be confused and insist that, no, there was a coding error, you need to get your doctor to fix it. But asking to speak to a supervisor can usually help with that. And then you can ask to have a note placed in the file so that it doesn't keep happening. The provider may have, if they're used to always submitting the claim as female, maybe they accidentally did submit it with the wrong gender for the person, so that could be an issue. Telling HR is another option because sometimes they can fix it. But this denial of sex specific care is something that trans people are still very concerned about, and they don't know that the reality is if you have the body parts and if you have medical necessity, then it's covered. You might have to, argue about it a little bit, but it is ultimately covered. But I get, I was just at a legal clinic. There was a gender conference East, which is mainly for trans youth. So I was working at the legal clinic, and the parents, that's the first question. They come in, they want to change their documents, they want to get the passport updated, But what are the implications for health insurance? Because I heard, and there's this persistent rumor, like, if we change it on the insurance, then my child won't be able to get coverage for a hysterectomy later on down the line, that kind of thing. Normally, Prezis are fun and quick. So, lack of medical necessity. Even if there's not an explicit exclusion of plan, sometimes the insurance company will still come back and say, well, we don't think that vaginoplasty is medically necessary. And they'll deny it on that basis. That's something that's, you know, as far as these goes, relatively easy to challenge because you just have to submit your standard medical evidence because the plan is going to have a definition of medical necessity, which will include things like we look at peer-reviewed literature, we look at clinical practice, we look at statements by medical societies. So you can assemble all of that because guess what? All the medical societies, the American Medical Association, the American Psychological Association, the American Psychiatric Association, the National Association of Social Workers, the World Professional Association for Transgender Health, you get the picture, have all come out and said that trans healthcare is medically necessary, not cosmetic. And then the hardest ones are the explicit exclusion for transgender-related care. And now, even when plans have coverage, have explicit coverage for trans-related care, there's this hidden medical policy. So you have your insurance plan, say it's Aetna, and you have the text of your plan booklet, but Aetna has a separate catalog of medical policies which determine when they're going to cover things and when they're not, based on medical need. So they'll have a separate policy on gender reassignment. And in there might be explicit exclusions. Insurance companies, in typical insurance company fashion, do things like exclude nipple reconstruction for transgender men. They'll say, well, okay, we'll get rid of your breasts, but we're not going to give you nipples, because that's cosmetic. They generally exclude breast reconstruction for trans women as cosmetic and frequently exclude facial reconstruction for trans women. So there might be these hidden exclusions within the insurance company. So in order to determine what legal protections apply to a specific plan, you first have to know what kind of plan it is. So there's, again, roughly five different types of plans. So there's employer-based, and within that, there's two different categories. Does anyone know what those are? Self-funded and insured. So a self-funded plan is something, a big company, that has offices in a bunch of different states, and through the magic of ERISA, the Employee Retirement Income Security Act, they can have the same plan in all 50 states. And what ERISA does is knocks out state law. It says you don't have to comply with state insurance regulations because this is not considered to be insurance. So a self-funded plan is where the employer has a pool of money that they collect, that they have set aside, and that is what is used to pay the claims. They hire an insurance company to administer the plan, but ultimately they are the ones, the company is the one that has the decision-making power as to what is covered and what is not. In practice, they tend to buy a plan. The insurance companies sell, you know, like a model plan, which the employer can alter as they see fit. Insured is for smaller employers, and that's where they buy a group policy, you know, from the insurance company. The insurance company is on the hook for paying the claims. And this is state law does apply, state insurance law applies to those plans. But there's a lot of confusion. People just see that their insurance card, and they say, oh, it says Aetna, I have Aetna insurance. Well, no, you might have a self-funded plan that's administered by Aetna. And I'm sorry, yes, you've heard about that wonderful insurance bulletin in New York, or whatever state you live in, but that does not apply to your plan. like this is probably Title VII. So, perhaps I should have learned it from the internet. So Title VII is the federal law that prohibits sex discrimination in employment. And it applies to employers who have 15 or more employees, and you have 300 days to file a charge. So that would, the clock starts running when someone gets a denial. So we have to, these are important to be mindful of, that the clock is ticking on certain protection when someone does get a denial letter. So Title VII extends to fringe benefits. So if the company is offering a plan that excludes benefits for trans folks, that's arguably sex discrimination. There have not been court cases stating that yet, but there are various cases pending. There's one in, I forget which state it's in, I think it's Oregon. The ACLU brought it against Dignity Health, which is a large Catholic health provider that has an explicit exclusion. But the EEOC, in its administrative process, has recognized that insurance exclusions can be discrimination. If you have any questions, you can jump in. if somebody bought their plan, yeah?
I was just wondering, are there any countries other than the U.S. that are more advanced in this area in providing gender reassignment surgery, et cetera?
Yeah, Cuba, Iran, Argentina, most of Europe, Canada, Brazil, so. So yeah, marketplace plans, if somebody bought their plan on the exchange, then they have all the protections under the Affordable Care Act, but not if they purchased it just as an individual plan directly from the insurer. Medicare. Medicare did have an explicit exclusion for many years that was eliminated. However, there's not been a national coverage determination providing for kind of affirmative coverage, so there's a lot of gray uncertainty. There's also no pre-authorization process for Medicare, so folks are left to, the providers are left to either, you know, potentially perform surgery, try to get reimbursement, but they may not be, it's not good. There's also problems there with reimbursement rates are very low for these surgeries under Medicare. Student health plans are their own thing. While employer-based plans don't have a lot of protections because of ERISA, which knocks out the state law, non-discrimination laws, state non-discrimination laws would apply to student health plans. So that's in some ways students have more protections. Medicaid, in theory, the Affordable Care Act means that there can be no more trans exclusions under Medicaid, but that has not trickled down yet into the ground in the implementation of it. There are a bunch of states where there is explicit coverage for trans-related care. Colorado is pending. Minnesota is being sued about it. New York has been sued about it and consequently changed their regulations. And in this area, there's a lot of movement. So for all of those types of plans, there's generally an internal appeal with the insurance company itself. And that's the first step that anyone would want to take when they get an insurance denial, if the simply calling up doesn't work. So you need to get letters of medical necessity from providers. And in an internal appeal, you would want to reference any state insurance bulletins. So New York State does not have any insurance laws specific to trans folks, but they have issued a bulletin saying, we interpret the following laws, such as the Mental Health Parity Act, other non-discrimination provisions, the Affordable Care Act, to mean that you cannot deny medically necessary care to trans folks simply because it's transgender related. So that's something you would want to reference. These internal appeals apply to both public and private plans, and you want to be aware if there's one or two internal appeals, because if there's only one, you want to make sure you do it right the first time. And it's also important because if it is an employer plan subject to ERISA, all ERISA says is that basically you have the right to enforce your rights under the contract, under the health insurance contract. So if your health insurance plan says it covers all medically necessary care, and there's no exclusion, the insurance company denies it for lack of medical necessity, you can go to court and prove that it was medically necessary and it should be covered. The court's review is very deferential to the insurance company, and you're not allowed to bring in new evidence. So whatever evidence you've got during the internal appeals process, that's it. So that's why it's important to have an attorney involved during the internal appeals process to preserve the rights going forward. If the internal appeal process doesn't work, then there's generally an external appeal available. So if it's a marketplace or employer plan, there's an independent review body in New York. It's not a state agency, it's an independent entity. There's several of them, the contract with the state. You have 4 months from the initial denial, not the final appeal denial, but the final adverse determination is generally considered to be the result of the first internal appeal. Another example, in Connecticut, for example, you have 120 days. So these are pretty short time frames. Again, it's important for people to be aware that the clock is ticking on these appeals. The independent review bodies can be very good. I had a case recently where it was for puberty suppression for a trans youth, and in this case, United Healthcare, in their medical policy, says they cover puberty suppression for precocious puberty, but it's considered not medically necessary for trans kids because it's experimental, unsafe, not enough studies, blah, blah, blah. So we submitted the appeal. The internal appeal, that didn't work. The external appeal, I would say that the external repeal agency like smacked down United Healthcare, and I was very surprised at the strength of the wording that they said, no, this is medically necessary, you can't deny it. And it's important to go through the external appeal process because that data gets collected, and and the insurance companies are answerable to that. If they're continually getting overturned on external appeal, that's indicating that they're doing something wrong. Medicaid, there's a fair hearing process. Again, it's very quick, turnaround. And if you're denied a fair hearing, you can go to court, but again, it's a deferential review. Medicare, there's an independent review entity, then you can go, it's a long process, then there's an administrative law judge, you can go all the way up to the Medicare Appeals Council and to court. There's even a way to get attorney's fees, but it's not necessarily straightforward. So if the external appeal doesn't work, there are other options as well. So Section 1557 of the Affordable Care Act is the non-discrimination provision of the Affordable Care Act. And it says you can't discriminate on the basis of sex, disability, race, I feel like I'm forgetting something. It doesn't say that, it says on the basis of Title IX, and then you look at Title IX, what is Title IX? Oh, it's sex discrimination. So then the question becomes, okay, so Section 1557 applies to federal, any entity that's receiving federal funding. So there's that hurdle. But that applies to most places because there's Medicare and Medicaid money, so providers are taking federal money, insurance companies are taking federal money. If an insurance company participates in an exchange marketplace, they are taking tax subsidies, which is considered to be federal funding. So, and once you're a covered entity, it applies to all of your plans, not just that particular plan that you're selling on the marketplace. But the question is, well, how does sex discrimination relate to trans folks? Is transgender discrimination sex discrimination? Courts have ruled on this in the context of Title VII and Title IX. And there was a case in, I think it was Wisconsin, no, Minnesota, I don't know. Where it was a trans man who tried to go to the emergency room and was treated horrifically. And that was the first case brought under Section 1557, and the court said, yes, transgender discrimination is sex discrimination. This does apply. And it took a long time, but this year, the regulations came out. The Federal Department of Health and Human Services issued regulations. So let's take a look at what they said more specifically. So with regard to sex-specific facilities, such as hospital rooms, drug use treatment programs, sex-specific screening programs like mammograms, it said you must treat the individuals according to gender identity. So, you know, prior to that, a trans woman could be denied drug treatment or say that she has to be housed with men. Sex-specific procedures. Services may not be denied because the individual is transgender or the gender reported in the medical record doesn't typically match the health service. So now that is on the books. You can't deny medical care just because of a gender mismatch. They also said you cannot have, you cannot categorically or automatically exclude from coverage or limit coverage for all health services related to gender transition. And then the backstop for that is, even if they don't have an exclusion, you cannot otherwise deny or limit coverage or deny a claim for specific health services related to gender transition if such denial or limitation results in discrimination. So for example, if there's no explicit exclusion, but they have a policy of consistently denying facial feminization as cosmetic, you can make the case that you're targeting trans folks for that. Labeling that surgery cosmetic is based on all these, animus, bias, the long history of labeling trans medical care as cosmetic. Just to be a little bit more clear about that, because I know people might not understand facial feminization or think that, well, how does it differ from a woman having a facelift? Facial reconstruction for trans women is a treatment for gender dysphoria. So there's a medical condition underlying it. It's not just, I want to make myself feel better about myself. There's a diagnosis, it's recognized. Secondly, faces are sex-specific. Even infants can distinguish male and female faces. And we can do this very readily when we look at someone. And there are specific facial features that are male and female. So the surgery is designed to change male facial features into female facial features. It's not designed to improve the appearance of a face. It's designed to change the sex of a face. If she, looks more attractive as a result, that's not the purpose. It's just like any other reconstructive surgery, burn victims. You know, you might look better because of it, but it's, you know, you're improving the function of that person. Yeah, I would just emphasize that, you know, that facial reconstruction is extremely important to many transgender women. They don't recognize themselves in the mirror. They're harassed continually when they walk down the street. And as we kind of move towards more acceptance for trans healthcare, the fight isn't over genital reconstruction. It's not over hormones or mental health care. It's over facial reconstruction, breast augmentation. And so that's where people need the most help right now. So, does Section 1557 apply? The answer is yes. Some restrictions apply. So what are those restrictions? There's this tricky area of third-party administrators. So Blue Cross, for example, sells plans on the marketplace. They are a covered entity under Section 1557. Blue Cross is administering your self-funded, employer-based health plan. Does Section 1557 apply to you? That's a good question. What the regulations say is the Department of Health kind of punted the issue, somewhat understandably, and they said that's a Title VII issue. They said they're going to kind of look at it and say that the employer is the one who chose the plan, the employer is the one who's on the hook. Go to the EEOC to file your complaint. Don't come here. But that doesn't really reflect the reality. So for example, I have a case now involving Blue Cross. I guess that's why I chose them. Where, in kind of in recognition, when Massachusetts passed its insurance bulletin and said you can no longer have trans exclusions because that's discriminatory, what they did in their model plan for self-funded plans, very quickly, this is confusing. They took out the exclusion and they put it in a rider. So if the company purchases the rider, then it's excluded. So some poor company, I don't know if they're getting a discount or not for having that rider. I guess I would assume so. Bought this plan, has Blue Cross administering their plan, and now it's like, wait a minute, you kind of actively chose to like choose this rider that actively discriminates against trans people. So to me, that's a pretty compelling case for discrimination, but it's also a compelling case that Blue Cross is the one who should be on the hook for aiding and abetting, for being agent of the employer, for however we, if I were the employer, I would definitely be pointing my finger at Blue Cross and saying, this is your fault. And some employers, some smaller employers, cannot buy insurance plans without an exclusion. If you're under 50 employees or something, the insurance companies don't necessarily offer this coverage. But to be clear, San Francisco, City of San Francisco was one of the first public entities to cover trans surgeries, and they have excellent cost data. Initially, they started charging higher premiums to their employees. The insurance companies initially were charging more for this coverage. But then all the insurance companies, once the data came in, once the use came in, and they saw that it was extremely low utilization and low cost, the insurance companies stopped charging a premium, and there's no basis, there's no actuarial basis to charge more for plans that include trans surgery versus plans that don't. So if you think about it, trans people have been subsidizing the healthcare for non-trans people all this time, because trans people have been paying the same premiums as everyone else, but not been getting the same healthcare benefits in return. But just as you wouldn't, healthcare plans cover surgery. They don't cover appendectomies, bypass surgery. The pricing isn't done that way. It doesn't. The only reason why we're even looking at the price of trans surgeries is because of the historical legacy of exclusion. And the question isn't, you know, how much does it cost to add this? It's how much money were you unlawfully saving by excluding it? But the reality is that it's really, as far as healthcare goes, it's not expensive, and providing the coverage actually does save a lot of money because you're not going to be having suicide attempts, you're not going to be needing drug treatment, you're not needing to go to therapy continually and have anti-anxiety drugs and depression drugs. And there's all kinds of random medical conditions that magically go away. People have like, you know, stomach problems and migraines, and it's just on and on. That getting the surgery and hormones just, you know, make the person healthy all around. You know, alcohol abuse, another thing. Cigarette smoking. So, that was a tangent, but but bottom line is there's no non-discriminatory justification for excluding trans healthcare. So that is all I have. Just a little slide with my contact information. And if you're interested in getting involved in working on healthcare appeals, or name changes for that matter, which are a little bit easier, feel free to contact me, and we can get you hooked up with that. Okay, so looking at the time here, we have about 15 minutes for questions if anybody wants to ask Noah anything.
Yes, I had a question. You had a lot of emphasis on the Affordable Care Act. Given the recent election and all the talk about potentially repealing or replacing that, is the law that was reflected in the Affordable Care Act reflected anywhere else that would be preserved in any different states, or does it fall within maybe like pre-existing conditions which may not get overturned, you know, that kind of thing?
Yeah, so on the repeal part, I would just comment that if, you know, I mean, obviously, if the Affordable Care Act itself were repealed, that's a huge segment of the population who's going to be affected by that, and a lot of people up in arms about that, so I'm not convinced that that's, you know, going to happen imminently. And specifically, Section 1557, it does protect, there's a lot of stuff in there about language accessibility, other, you know, sex discrimination stuff. So women's health groups were very involved in the notice and comment process for those regulations. So there's definitely a lot of folks lined up to defend the Affordable Care Act and the non-discrimination provisions. But if it does get repealed, first, you sort of can't put the genie back in the bottle. So once, you know, the federal government has come out and declared that trans exclusions are sex discrimination, that exclusions themselves are discrimination, because there's some question about that. When I was, you know, one of my very early cases, you know, Blue Cross said, you know, sex reassignment is just a surgery we don't provide to anybody. It's not discrimination. Well, now we've moved the dialogue, okay, it's discrimination. So even if there's no explicit federal protections, so Title VII still exists. Title IX would apply to any university-based health insurance plan, and also some others. Then we would fall back on state law. So both statewide non-discrimination law could apply in some cases, but although that they've also been interpreted, for example, in New York, the New York human rights law is the non-discrimination law has been held not to apply to insurance, so then you have to look to state insurance law. Most states have provisions that prohibit unfair discrimination, generically. They also have provisions that prohibit sex discrimination, disability discrimination, So I think that certainly in, you know, friendlier states, and about 17 or maybe 18 now states have passed insurance bulletins that prohibit gender identity discrimination in insurance. So there are a lot of protections that can be tapped. And also, in advance, so January 1 is when the provisions that require plan changes go into effect. So in advance of that, insurance companies are changing the plans. Blue Cross of North Carolina, for example, said that it was going to get rid of exclusions in its self-funded plans that it administers unless the employer signs a waiver indemnifying Blue Cross for any discrimination. So it's a little hard for me to imagine that these insurance companies are going to start putting exclusions back into their plans once they've taken them out. Because in some ways, it's not, you know, again, it's not really hurting their bottom line that much at all. I think they're going to find that when they start getting data. And just from an advocacy perspective, I think that doing more advocacy with private entities, with the employers, with the insurance companies is one way to help preserve those rights. Because employers don't, you know, there is pressure that can be put on them. There's the human rights campaigns, corporate equality index. People like to get 100% on that. In order to get 100%, you have to have trans inclusive healthcare. So, you know, that's something that's already out there that's a positive, you know, mechanism to get folks to make these changes and to maintain it even in the face of, you know, uncertainty at the federal level. Okay.
Lynn, the legal put out a really comprehensive packet regarding hospital policies and treatment for transgender, I'm sure you're familiar with it. Have you seen like a lot of like, it seems to be very widely adopted that people are generally agreeing that that is like the best method of treatment. It seems to be very, pro-trans people and also helping to like decrease discrimination. My question would be like, do you agree with that? Do you think that that is like the proper method? Do you think that there's a lot of law backing Lend Illegal with a lot of, because I know there's very few, very limited case law, and I know you mentioned a lot of like external appeals cases and stuff. I don't know how you, what your opinion on that is.
Yeah, with hospitals, public accommodations laws would apply, so there's a lot more state level protections in play there. There's also the Joint Commission, which accredits hospitals, and they have non-discrimination provisions for transgender folks in their, you know, in order to be accredited with them, you have to, you can't discriminate based on that. So that's a big hammer that hospitals don't want to have the Joint Commission looking at them. I would say that those best practices are our best practices, but they certainly don't translate throughout the country. I think in New York, the Attorney General is actively working with hospitals to get them to update their policies and get on board. But in other states, you know, you're still definitely having blatant discrimination.
Okay. Hi. Do you think the extension of trans rights will help other folks? For example, in Brooklyn, are impoverished women if they have radical mastectomy for breast cancer cannot get nipple reconstruction. And do you think the appeals process itself kind of hides the issues from the courts and really is stood in, you know, medically getting denials and having to go through an appeals process rather than to a court, kind of hides the issue and doesn't bring it out to where it needs to be seen?
Yeah, that's. I think that's accurate. You know, one of the reasons I didn't mention as to why I personally think that explicit exclusions came into existence was an early case in New York against Aetna in 1979, where Aetna tried to deny it under the cosmetic exclusion, and they went to court, and the court said, like, in no way is this cosmetic surgery. And then, you know, if the insurance companies want to continue to deny it, and that's why they put in the explicit exclusions. But I think that, you know, until recently, you know, it was scary to go to court for trans folks. And, you know, you certainly risk setting that precedent about the medical necessity of trans care. So I think that's one reason why people would shy away from that. But I do think that these cases will be going forward. And I'm involved in a case in Oregon we had a fair hearing for facial feminization. And the fair hearing said very clearly this is medically necessary, but Oregon has rationed health care and they can deny medically necessary care. So we're looking into bringing it in court. So I think, long story short, yes, we are at the point now where we are winning these cases at the appeals levels, and it's about time that we'll be moving into court. And I think that will help other folks. Yeah.
So we've had cases where a patient has come to the hospital and they've identified with a different gender than when they were there previously. And so their medical record is with the previous gender. Their insurance is with the previous gender. And all their identification is, but yet they're identifying. So we have to honor that identification. But then the reconciliation, and that's where the problem is, the medical record. How do you suggest that the insurance company, because they don't know. And, you know, and then we're in this quandary because we're trying to honor the rights of the transgender individual, but yet there's no reconciliation with anything, any other legal documentation.
Yeah.
The hospital. Social security number. What is this? Social security.
The hospital guide that was referenced earlier has specific recommendations about that, and I understand that there are limitations to computer systems, and that tends to be where the sticking point is, like, oh, we can't change our database and our forms and stuff, but that, you know, having a field for preferred name and pronoun and, you know, gender is one way to, you know, hold those two things at the same time.
But with the insurance company.
Yeah, with the insurance company, you have to, you know, file with the legal name and gender.
Yeah.
But, you know, educating the billing department about that and about the issues that come up with sex-specific procedures and you know, there's a lot of education work that can be done to help smooth out those problems.
But if you're filing with the legal name and gender, the legal name and gender with the insurance company is different. The Social Security number changes. Would remain the same.
Well, you just file with whatever's on their insurance card.
That's what I'm saying. I'm saying that what do you do when the patient comes in and they haven't changed anything yet, but yet we're trying to honor their gender identity.
Mm-hmm.
So we're honoring who they say they are, but all of the documentation doesn't reflect that.
Yeah, so you would have a field on their chart for their preferred name.
I understand that.
So I think the question is getting to how do you honor the person's preference while still making that preference clear to the insurance company? And I think the answer is, unfortunately, in a lot of ways, you don't. You file with whatever's on file with the insurance company until such time as those changes are made, and you follow your internal practices with regard to respecting the person's identity for your own purposes.
Well, what if they're seeking medical care for something that has to do with the newer gender, the new gender, transform gender, but yet it hasn't been changed yet with the insurance? It's problematic for hospitals, and we're trying to reconcile this, but it becomes
Yeah, we do this all the time for our transgender clinics. We just call the insurance company and let them know what's gone down, speak to the medical director, and then have them speak to their business. You have to make sure the patient agrees. Yeah,
absolutely.
And you advocate on their part with the insurance company because they don't know how to notify them. And then all your billing issues are settled. You just have to make sure that it is placed formally in their file and on their record, both at your house as well as with the insurance company. Otherwise, every time they come back, there's another denial, there's another problem. But you have to advocate for that patient, and often it gets brought to me because I'm the medical director of ambulatory care, and I've got to get on the horn, and I have to speak with the medical director because, you know, when you get put online with insurance companies, you're talking to high school graduates in general.
Absolutely.
And they have no idea what
right.
to do. And then when you finish with the medical director, you make sure you talk to their billing people or the person in charge of billing, and then you're set. You write it on, you know, you document it on your medical or hospital record. You make sure you have alternative fields for names and gender, and that's what you respect going forward. But you have to advocate for that patient with the insurance company, and you're not going to do it on the ground level. You've got to get to the medical director and the head of billing. And it works.
Was your firm involved at all in any of the litigation in North Carolina? I visited a friend in Asheville, which is, seems to be the only liberal enclave in North Carolina, and what they had was they had all gender, every restaurant out there had all gender restrooms. So was your firm involved at all?
No, but I did change the name of the lead plaintiff in the ACLU's lawsuit. That's my only connection.
Role of the press has been in all of this, and are they more of an advocate for transgender folks these days? Does it make your job any easier?
In general, outside of the healthcare context?
I think including healthcare also.
Yeah. I would say that Laverne Cox and Caitlin Jenner have made my job a lot easier, and they've done tremendous work that I could have never done. I think that the coverage that I've seen, there was a, you know, when New York got rid of the Medicaid exclusion several years ago, the administration was very concerned about public backlash, and that just never materialized. I have a Google alert for all of the trans health and trans insurance news stories, and they're all positive. The comments, negative, but People are covering these openings of the gender clinics. They're covering people's struggles with getting access to healthcare. It's a pretty big topic, so I think that it's very helpful.
Other questions? Okay, we have about 2 minutes before the official start of the next segment. So if everybody wants to kind of get up and stretch or get set up.
Noah is going to be joined by Chris Chawanta. And then we'll have questions at the end to either or the other or both of them.
Thank you very much, Professor Dolgen. I join my friend and colleague, Noah, in thanking Hofstra and Gitenstein for helping us put this together. And of course, at our level, for the generous support of our CLE series, we certainly could not do it without you. The title of this session, as you'll notice, is a little bit more general, because while I do want to talk about healthcare in a sense, I also want it to be a session about cultural competencies in representing transgender clients. It is my firm belief that you cannot ethically represent a group of people, any group of people, whether it's trans folks or what's, you know, my expertise, people with disabilities, or
any group, unless you truly understand the cultural norms and situations that they're in. And so the conversation today will start out with a little bit of that and move into a discussion of the ethics of legal strategy and building partnerships with the assets that you have available to you in the community as an attorney. And then I thought it might be interesting to close the day, and I did ask Noah beforehand, and he has indicated that he is fine with this. I thought it might be interesting to have a conversation about Noah's experience as the first trans person to graduate from Harvard. I thought that that might be a nice ending piece. So that's the game plan for today's session. As we're having our conversation, I don't want you to feel like you have to wait until the end to ask a question. If you feel compelled or so moved to jump in, simply raise your hand, and as soon as the current question on the table has been completed, the answer, we will get to you. We want this to be not just a conversation between us, but a conversation between all of us. So the first question I think I have for you, Noah, in the vein of sort of cultural competency is, what are some of the pitfalls that somebody who might not have experience representing trans folks might encounter in their dealings with that population?
I think one of the anxieties is just, well, you know, interacting with trans folks. I mentioned during the break that most people, surveys show, don't know that they know a trans person, whereas the figures are much higher for gay people. There are fewer trans people in the world, and if you're walking down the street, or you know, you're interacting with me, most people don't know that I'm trans. So there's just that, you know, nervousness, am I going to say the wrong thing? So just acknowledging that, and one of the things that's important, we did not do a kind of a trans 101 training as part of this, but that is something that law firms can do, that is something that hospitals can do, to get all the staff on board, to know that people are maybe coming through the door who don't, you know, whose name might not match their identity documents, who might be visibly transgender. So just a quick couple of points on pronouns. Someone comes into your office, your clinic, and you don't know what pronoun they prefer because they're visibly transgender or gender nonconforming, it is acceptable to ask that person what pronoun they use. And sometimes the answer might be they. They, as a gender-neutral pronoun, is what we have in the English language. That's kind of the dominant gender-neutral pronoun that folks are using. So someone who doesn't identify as male or female, they might identify as non-binary, they might use the pronoun they. And similarly, if you mess up somebody's name or pronoun, you know, you want to correct yourself and move on. But don't make a big deal about it, that, you know, but it is important to correct yourself. Another area that might come up is, what bathroom should the person use? They should use the bathroom that corresponds to their gender identity. Don't assume that all trans people want to use a gender-neutral bathroom. Sometimes when I go to speak, people say like, oh, there's a gender-neutral bathroom on the 10th floor. If you want to go up there, I'm like, no, I'm happy with the men's room. So anywhere of that, and making, again, sure that they're not going to be stared at in the restroom by staff or other folks in wherever you're at.
You know, I'm so glad that in particular you said, you know, can you hear me? I feel like maybe the microphone isn't picking up as good as I'd like it to. Everybody can hear me? Okay, perfect. Okay, so I'm so glad that you mentioned that, you know, if a person makes a mistake, to just simply apologize, correct yourself, and move on, because I have seen people that don't have experience representing transgender folks make mistakes, and they make such a big deal out of it because they, you know, it's coming from a good place, because obviously they want to do the right thing, they want to honor the person's identity. But they make such a big deal about it that I get the impression that the person is substantially more uncomfortable than they would have been if the attorney or the law student had just moved on from it. Because now, what you've done is told that client, I am uncomfortable. And as soon as you do that, I think you lose part of the trust that your client has to have in you. If your client is constantly worried, you know, are they so incredibly self-conscious because they're so worried about offending me? Well, then I don't know about you, but I would start having questions in my mind. Is my attorney really listening to me? Or are they devoting so much energy into this one singular concern, which is an important concern, don't get me wrong, that their attention is diverted away from where it really needs to be on the facts and circumstances of the individual's case or name change or whatever it may be. Now, when we talk about obstacles to access, obviously, trans folks have been historically marginalized and have had less access to a variety of services, be they legal or medical. And so I wondered if you would talk for a few minutes about obstacles that trans folks face, both in their day-to-day lives and in the context of accessing legal services, and what we as attorneys might be able to do within the bounds of ethics to make life a little bit easier for them, even beyond the confines of their strict legal case or matter.
Sure. Trans folks are disproportionately impoverished. The rate's about 15% as compared to 4% of the general population, so people are struggling to access housing, employment, in terms of being able to come to an appointment, being able to afford, in the city, even a metro card fare is often a barrier for folks. There's also the safety issue that people face when leaving their house. If somebody is visibly transgender, they may face harassment of varying levels. Transgender and walking down the street, you might hear whispers, that's a man, to worse. There's lots of videos on YouTube showing women being harassed on the subway, sometimes quite scarily by other folks and people not intervening. So it's not a simple matter of show up to the appointment at this time. It's building up the courage, knowing that you're going to face all of this stigma and harassment on your way to the appointment. There's also, a trans woman might not be able to just leave the house, without wearing makeup, without making sure that she looks as female as possible for her own safety. So it's a big barrier. There's also the issue of depression in the community, that people are very hopeless and get discouraged very easily. So if there's some setback, if they get that insurance denial, they get it, some can't find some document for their name change, it's the end of the world and they just want to give up. And then they're not returning your calls, they're not showing up for appointments. And a provider and attorney might interpret that as, this person doesn't care about the name change, they don't care about getting their health care. Well, it's not that, it's the systemic discrimination that the folks are facing.
You know, one of the things that I recalled as you were answering the question, when I was working with you at Tilda some years ago, one of the things that I noticed is obviously not every call that you get in to the office is a case that's going to go anywhere. Sometimes there's just nothing there, or sometimes, unfortunately, as much as we would like to help, there's just nothing that can be done in an individual's particular case. But one thing that I found useful to sort of keep in mind, I've had this experience too, both as an advocate for people with disabilities and as a person with a physical disability myself. Sometimes the most valuable service we provide is being an actual human being who's actually willing to listen. Because I will guarantee you, there are a number of trans people, a number of people with disabilities, and another a number of people from other historically marginalized or discriminated against populations where that is not their day-to-day experience. And so what I would say in terms of obstacles, just to add to what Noah has so eloquently already said, is that sometimes just being there is a service in itself. Now, obviously, we're lawyers. We have busy schedules. We can't, you know, spend hours on end just, you know, necessarily listening to people who have no claim. But to the extent that your schedule allows it, and to the extent that you understand that, you know, a trans person coming to you has placed in you a tremendous amount of trust and faith. More, I would venture to say, and perhaps Noah, you know, if you disagree with me, you know, feel free to chime in here, but I would venture to say substantially more than even your typical client. I would also hasten to add that, as we all know, unless you are in the transactional business where you're helping people close on a new house or do a happy event like that, most people who come to our offices are not happy to be there. And to the extent that we can provide sort of emotionally supportive environments for them to say what they need to say and be heard, we're doing a service that goes far beyond just providing legal services. When I say just providing, I don't mean to minimize the legal services. Those are important. But if a person doesn't feel like they can speak freely, like they're in a place where they're actually being heard, how can you as an attorney be completely confident that you've gotten everything that you need? You know, there may be things that are embarrassing or difficult for a client to talk about. But, you know, to the extent that it comes up in the context of surgery, you know, I hasten to say people are often pretty shy and timid about talking about genitals and things like that. And to the extent that you can cultivate an environment of trust in a world where so many of this members of this population have had to live in a constant state of distrust, in a constant state of having to keep the walls up, proverbially. To the extent that you can demonstrate to your client that you are willing to work to get behind those walls, you have an ethical obligation to do that. You know, I when I teach cases to students, whether I'm giving a lecture for Gitenstein or whether I'm guesting in a colleague's class on disability law, I always add that I've never been a fan of the way that cases have been traditionally framed, which is, what are the facts of this case? I always frame the question like this: who is Jones and what's his, her, their problem? Because I think framing it that way reminds us that these are not just sets of legal facts coming to us with a problem to solve. These are real people whose lives are now in our hands. And I know as attorneys, you might feel like, oh, I'm being lectured to, you know, I know all of this stuff. And I know you do. But I never get tired of saying it, because I have had people come to me after seeing other attorneys that have disabilities that did not feel like they were treated as a person, that felt like all the attorney was seeing was the wheelchair, or the walker, or the speech device, or whatever it was that, you know, they were using, or the white cane. So to the extent that you can cultivate empathy and make a conscious effort to do that without undermining the skills that you've been in legal advocacy. In other words, it can't be such a conscious thought that you forget everything else that you know. But it has to be a thought. You mentioned that things like metro cards and things like that can be scarce resources. Talk about what you might want to do in terms of building the partnerships in the community to get people the kinds of non-legal help that we can't necessarily provide, that we could build those partnerships in the community we're referring to, and how that works.
Yeah, in the name change context, for example, I'm working with Northwell Health. They have a new trans clinic, so we're trying to systematize getting all their patients' name changes. So, and, you know, working with the LGBT Community Center in Suffolk to host a name change clinic there. So it is easier to reach out to existing organizations and that have their own networks, and then it becomes mutual, and I can refer folks back to them, to their support groups, to their medical providers. I think that, you know, getting in a climate, you know, we tend to think of legal protections as being the end all be all, but there's also just community organizing and getting folks connected to resources. And I think that that's something going forward that, you know, we'll need to refocus our efforts on, and making sure that the folks are connected, because a lot of trans people are isolated, I think, particularly on Long Island. If they don't know any other trans folks, then, you know, they might know some folks on the internet, but getting them in touch with local trans folks is really important, because there's a lot of information that gets passed around in person meetings and support that to counteract all of the other stigma and discrimination that folks are facing. Getting peer support is very important. I think we have a question. The nationwide is 1.4 million. I don't know off the top of my head what the New York figures are, but it's definitely disproportionately high in New York City. A lot of folks from more rural areas come to New York, often with no resources, and they've come to plan on living in homeless shelters until they can make it here.
Yes?
Do you think that there's a lot of discrimination? I think one of the big challenges I've seen as a physician who's an attorney is the bias on the part of providers. I mean, even gay providers don't want to take care of transgender patients. That's a real problem. I tried to set up a trans clinic back in 1995, and the resistance I got was not from hospital administration, but it was from the providers. And I tried to get our gay providers online, you know, to advocate with me to get it. It's not that they didn't want to be identified, it's that they didn't want to put in the effort. They didn't care. So what I did to finally become successful was to go through our STAR and our HEAT programs, where there were services, where there were sensitive providers who were accepting of folks, and that's been a huge success. The biggest problems we face is, of course, what we've heard about today, dealing with insurance companies and getting services paid for. But if you advocate on the right level, you'll generally, at least today, be successful. But I think there's a lot of, and I see it from the inside, there's a lot of bias in the medical community against trans folks. Would you agree?
Yeah, I mean, we're actually going to get to that in significantly more detail in a second, so I'm glad that you asked that question, but I'll let Noah.
Yeah, I would say, I'm a very passionate person, so my first response is it was not their fault. They didn't get any training in medical school. Thankfully, that is changing now. There are efforts to institute this and, you know, bring actual trans people into the classrooms and so people, you know. But yeah, but it's absolutely true that the bias and ignorance of society is definitely reflected in the medical profession. And it's very scary to think about that. You know, if you read that Rumble case, it's pretty horrific. You know, here's somebody who came in for emergency services and, you know, was not being treated appropriately. There's an older case from Washington, D.C. where paramedics came to help somebody, you know, discovered that she was transgender, and they stopped helping her, and she died. So it's definitely a serious problem.
I do want to to follow up on that. Before we leave the topic of access to resources, I did want to run something by you. One of the approaches that some, I know, in the legal services community have taken, to the extent that, you know, either grant money or external funding from the private bar allow them to do this, is to actually say to a person who maybe is low income enough that, you know, the price of a MetroCard is too high, to say, you need a MetroCard? Here's your MetroCard. You need, you know, a suit to show up to court? You know, here's a gift card to Joseph A. Bank. What is your opinion on that sort of direct help, and is it something that can be effectively done on a large scale?
Well, there's definitely ethical problems with with facilitating lawsuits, and
right.
So there's that. I think, you know, there's a movement now. Some folks are raising money because to change your passport, it's $135 to get a new passport, something like that. So it's great that the policy was changed on the ground that you can get the passport with your new gender, but if you can't afford that, and if you're living in a state where your driver's license cannot be changed, then you need that federal document to be the only document you have that reflect your gender. Those are cost prohibitive. So there's definitely kind of an endless supply, you know, people could raise money for that kind of thing. I've been involved with some policy work regarding New York State birth certificates. The correction fee for those is pretty expensive, so we're asking them to waive that fee for low-income folks. But you know, even just getting your basic identity documents is sometimes cost prohibitive. You know, a New York City birth certificate costs $50. Sometimes people can't afford that. So I think there is a need for more community organizing around that.
I just want to add to that. I mean, Noah, you sort of said it, but and I never know kind of what you have in mind when you ask these questions.
Yeah.
You're usually throwing a wrench into everybody's network for the good. But I think that kind of gift can be terribly destructive, and Noah's answer really speaks to that, because it'll preclude the kind of advocacy that changes things in a really fundamental way for everybody. So you think, okay, I gave six clients money for a passport, so I don't have to worry about it. Well, not true. Those six clients have money for a passport. They haven't changed a basic and unjust rule.
Thank you, because that was actually, sort of the direction in which I was going. The piecemeal approaches, while they're nice and you know, solve the initial problem, one, I think they do raise some ethical concerns. And two, at least from where I sit, that sort of approach, at least in the long term, if you're a cause lawyer, is sort of kicking the can down the road, right? You haven't addressed the systemic problems that are leading those folks to be in that situation in the first place, which is sort of where I was going with the question. I don't know if it was terribly clear.
It was too. You're good.
Oh, there's questions. I don't see.
Okay.
Yeah.
I have another one. I want that question. Is there a requirement to mental health counseling before there's any actual medical treatment? Because that's not something I know. And second question is, are there any better role models other than Caitlyn Jenner and Vern Cox? Because if there are more than a million trans, and you have two women that are really very about their cosmetic appearance, and doesn't that really create a lot of stereotypes and misinformation in and of itself? Because not all women present themselves that way.
Okay, so first question. There are two major standards of care. There's the WPATH, the World Professional Association for Transgender Health Standards of Care, that's the BIDI, and then there's the Endocrine Society standards. Neither one of those doesn't really have an informed consent model, but on the ground, clinics like Helen Lord provide hormones on an informed consent basis. Generally, there's at least one, you know, social worker interview, you know, to make sure that the person understands what the treatment will do to them. But there's no requirement for psychotherapy, and there is no requirement in the WPATH standards of care for therapy. You know, it's recommended, but it's not a requirement. For genital surgery, there's a requirement for two letters, one from a PhD level person, and that's not like a requirement, right? It's not, obviously there's no law about it, but that's the standard practice, and that WPATH standard has been adopted by insurance companies in kind of a negative way, but sometimes they'll misapply it and say you need two letters for chest surgeries, which isn't the case. You only need one letter under the WPATH standards, and there's a movement within WPATH to get rid of that two-letter requirement. It's a bit cumbersome, unnecessary. It tends to be kind of surgeons are the ones who are all, like, the gatekeepers in terms of what they want to see. Some have more stringent, some less stringent. Yeah.
There's also the policies and procedures that hospitals and institutions set that really determine the local standards. And sometimes they're, you know, they'll require education or a psychiatric evaluation, not just to make sure, A, the patient is competent, and B, that they really understand what the outcome of the surgery or the outcome of the therapy will be. And like everything in the court, it depends upon how it's applied. It can be applied in a very conservative, nasty way to keep people from getting treatment, or it can be applied in a way that's really educational and fair to our patients and clients so that they really understand what's going to happen. And I just wanted to make one more comment about the systemic, and you're right about that, because it's not only trans folks who have trouble getting to access medical services. And so one of the things that we advocated for, that we actually got for our patients in Brooklyn from Health First and several other managed care, Medicaid managed care organizations, were Metro cards, so they would have transportation to and from their medical appointments, and that solves the problem for poor folks, for trans folks who are poor, for everybody who's poor. And I think that the way you fix things, because I'm currently working in district and trying to fix things at downstate, is you have to fix the system, because then that makes healthcare access for everybody. That makes it fair, I think, for folks in general. And while we all recognize that trans folks have certainly had more than their fair share of issues to deal with in our society, when you kind of level the playing ground, it can work either way. If you get rights for trans folks, other folks come in, like my patients with radical mastectomy who can't get nipple reconstruction. Or if you level the playing field for everybody, then trans folks come in. So I think systems, fixing systems are really the key.
So,
So I'm going to push back on you a little bit about the second question. There's a book called Whipping Girl by Julia Serrano, and in there she makes the case that a lot of the animosity towards that is directed at transgender women is actually directed at femininity. And a lot of the trans women, you know, who I know, they are feminine, and they really embrace that, and they feel that it's very powerful. And there are femme women, too, who embrace their femininity and get a lot of flack for that. So I would just be very careful about saying that, you know, Laverne Cox is not a good role model because she...
I'm not a better role model.
Yeah.
Other role models, not even better. She's opposite to them. Necessarily represent the entire trans. I don't know.
I really appreciated your bringing that up, and I think one of the issues here, you know, you seem to assume some understanding of femininity that's really different from my understanding. So I think there are a lot of ways to be, as it were, feminine, to exhibit femininity that don't depend, and there are special issues with trans women because where they may actually be crucial to presenting yourself in a certain way, but to assume that somehow that if one is feminine, one has to do that stuff, I think is a really bad presumption.
Well, the reality is so.
Well,
and I see the whole thing. And I think I'm a powered person. I understand a lot of this, but if there's no mental health component that's required, and you're talking about people that maybe are just coming to an awareness of their situation or coming discussing with their families or their friends, and there might be some confusion about gender identity or are they transsexual, is there something else going on? If there's no real mental health component in the beginning of that process, and then I don't really understand how we want the public to accept this idea that everything should be covered and everything's okay and just get doctor approval. We know plastic surgeons authorize surgeries that they shouldn't for women, find most jobs or whatever it is, it happens all the time. And there is a mental health screening, I think, for those people. So why would there be for this for trans?
There is a mental health screening.
Like a requirement,
Well, I don't know that. I mean, that it would be required any more than it's required for any other surgery. I mean, I think it's as a matter of practice that is what.
Christine.
I know her
because
she's
a student of mine. So now that I've been to her, started calling her on my name.
Thank you. I was just wondering. You mentioned earlier about better access to healthcare in other countries. I was wondering if you guys could speak about how many people seek medical tourism to meet their healthcare in the transgender community.
I don't have a statistic, but Thailand has historically been a very popular destination to get high quality surgery for low cost. Even considering airfare, it's still cheaper.
And then another question I have is the reason that other countries that you mentioned have better healthcare, access to healthcare for transgender, because they're more respectful and tolerant, or is it another factor? Do they go hand in hand? Is that what drives it, or is it another factor?
Yeah, it's because they have better healthcare access for everyone.
Right.
So is that healthcare?
Which goes so importantly to the issue of systemic change. Where anyone is going to find benefit in a society, it's mostly because where anyone who is in one way or another is advantaged, it's because everyone is. It's so
So I think the next question I have has been fleshed out a lot already, just in the back and forth that we've been having. But when you talk about access to competent and compassionate medical services in the trans community, you mentioned Helen Ward, which came to my mind as a very, very LGBT friendly place to go. But in terms of, a client comes to you and says, I need to find a provider who is going to understand the concerns and deal with them competently. If anything, do you see as the scope of your ethical obligation to do some due diligence and have that information available to them to refer?
Yeah, it's definitely a problem. And there's also the problem of, I would say, being concerned about malpractice and sending it to someone who is a butcher or, just doesn't do high quality surgery work. So I'm always very careful to say, here are some surgeons that I know perform these surgeries, but I encourage you to do your own investigation. I can't vouch for any of them. Trans folks have put together lists. There are lists on the internet. There are, there's like several competing websites. Trans folks have been trying to get organized and come up with these lists of trans-friendly providers, which, you can send people